Let's look at what the average person can do to not just survive inflation, but to thrive. What kind of investments or financial moves do you need to make in order to come out on the other side better than when you went in? Going back to my pool analogy, I don't want anyone to drown while we cover this, so let's do a quick review of inflation and hyperinflation, and even the Fed's new term, transitory inflation. If you know this stuff already, stick with me. It'll be real quick. Go grab another dew while you wait or fill up your coffee cup. Okay, first there is inflation. It feels like prices are going up, and they may be going up a little, but what is really happening is the purchasing power of your money is going down. So maybe that $200,000 house last year will now cost you $250,000. That's inflation. Hyperinflation is the same thing, but, well, it's hyper. What does it mean to be hyper something? If we call someone hyper emotional, then they are super emotional. Hypersensitive means they are sensitive, but super sensitive. Same type of thing for hyperinflation. You can think of it as superinflation. It means inflation has reached epic proportions. Economists aren't completely agreed on what constitutes hyperinflation or superinflation as opposed to regular inflation, but Investopedia says it's hyperinflation when it reaches 50% per month. In my house and my economy, I'll consider it hyperinflation way before inflation is occurring at that rate. So forget the number. Just know that hyperinflation is fast. It's super fast. It's superinflation, and it tends to happen slowly at first and then rapidly. So it may hurt a little, and then a little more, and then a little more, but before you know it, it's too late. We've all felt a little of the impact of a devaluing of our dollar. The Federal Reserve, or Fed, likes to call what we're going through right now as transitory inflation. This is the same Federal Reserve that told us in 2008 that there was no problem with the subprime mortgage industry, and everything was going to be just fine. Transitory inflation is just a phrase that somebody came up with to help keep the masses from panicking. But calling inflation transitory won't change anything, and it certainly won't make it transitory. So here's the deal. Let's talk about boiling a frog to death. Okay, it's been said if you throw a frog in hot water, it'll immediately jump out. But if you put it in a pot of water, let it get comfortable, and then heat it up slowly over time to boiling, that frog will sit there until he cooks to death. Why? Because the heat came slowly and the frog didn't realize what was happening. In this situation, the Federal Reserve is the chef, the pot is the economy or society, and we, well, unfortunately, we are the frogs. Some frogs are gonna come to a slow boil until it's too late, but a few of us are gonna see what's coming, know that somebody's gonna get burnt, and hop out of the pot. So maybe if we play our cards right, we can even profit from this period of inflation or hyperinflation instead of just letting it run us over like a freight train. So if you believe that this is certainly not transitory inflation, as the Fed would have you believe, then let's explore what you can do to turn a profit in the next few years and come out on top after inflation has done its damage. But before I get too far into this, I want to give you this very clear disclaimer. All information in this video is for entertainment purposes only and not financial advice. Please consult with your financial advisor before making any financial decisions at all. In my last video, I told you to think of me as your buddy at the bar. Well, today, think of me as your drunk buddy at the bar because everything I'm going to talk about is theory, conjecture, and speculation at best. I have never lived through massive inflation. I've never been through hyperinflation. And let's be honest, transitory inflation didn't even exist before somebody in Washington came up with that combination of words. So I guess what I'm saying is that I'm reminding you again, I'm only guessing and only speculating in this video. Take everything I say with a grain of salt. Some of the ideas I have could work, some could be total crap. For every idea I have, I'm sure there are 10,000 scenarios I never thought of. Okay, great. Now that we got that out of the way, proceed at your own risk. The good news is I'm not a fat cat rich bloke. All the strategies I'm sharing are for the average person with average financial means. I guess I'm like your broke drunk buddy at the bar trying to figure out how to turn a profit from scratch. So without further ado, here's how you can turn a profit during inflation or hyperinflation. During inflation, and especially during hyperinflation, the worst thing to have is fiat money because that's exactly what's losing its value. And for lack of a better term, fiat money is just paper currency, government paper currency that's not backed by gold. It's better to invest that money into something that's going to retain its value than it is to hold on to it. So what are some of the options? Some of it depends on how much cash you have available. So get rid of your cash while you can. Once everybody wants to dump it, it's too late. One of the best investments you can convert that cash to is real estate. Regardless of how bad inflation gets, or even if we enter into hyperinflation, people need a place to live. As the owner of the real estate, you will benefit by the rise in the market value, both in terms of selling and in terms of renting, because the market value will rise with inflation. Let's suppose we have a year with 100% inflation rate. That means a year later, everything costs double what it did before. It also means the value of things other than cash has doubled. So if you have $150,000 in cash, a year later, it would only have the purchasing power of about half of that, or $75,000. But if you bought a $150,000 house, a year later, it would be worth double that, or $300,000. The same type of thing happens with rent. Let's assume you have a house that rents for $1,500, and we have the same inflationary deal. We have a year where the value of money declines by 100%. Again, everything costs double. If you're renting out your investment house to a tenant, the new market rent would be $3,000 instead of $1,500. As long as you bought that real estate with a fixed interest rate, your payment isn't going to change that much. It might change a little bit with taxes from year to year, but that's about it. If you've ever heard of people talking about wanting to inflate out of debt, that's how it's done, and that's why inflation and semi-hyperinflation can be so powerful for people who have assets they still owe on. As the money loses value, the market rents increase, it can become easier and easier to pay the mortgage off early. If you can completely pay it off, as inflation increases, it will be a cash cow once inflation settles. I'm not an expert on this. I only have one rental and it's not paid off, but I imagine during hyperinflation, people would pay their rent before they pay their other debts. Nobody wants to lose the roof above their head. If you have a good nest egg or a pile of cash, what you don't want to do is keep a bunch of cash on hand. Inflation and hyperinflation will eat away at it until it's worthless. So convert it into real estate or some other hard asset that will retain its value as inflation rises. I usually do not promote debt in any way, but if you like taking gambles, you can stomach a little risk, and you want to get really slick. But before I say this, remember, this is just theory and my advice shouldn't be taken seriously. Consult with your financial advisor before making any financial decisions. Thank you. Okay, what do you do if you want to get slick? If you want to get really slick and you are convinced hyperinflation was coming, you could buy as many houses as possible with as little down as possible and borrow the rest. Let's say you were able to put money down and buy two houses on a fixed rate, both worth $200,000. As they rose with inflation, eventually one would be worth $400,000. You could sell it and pay the other one off, and then you'd be debt-free on that house. If you had lots of cash, you could do that with as many houses as possible, just buying pairs of houses, knowing that you will sell one as soon as the value is there to justify it. You could also do it with 3, 4, or 5 houses. You could buy 5 houses, let inflation go up a little bit, sell 4 of them, and pay one off. That's just one option. Okay, but maybe you're like me and you just don't have the cash to go do that, or you're not willing to take on extra debt to try to make it happen on a chance that you'll game the system and win. I get it. I've already used up my 3.5% FHA loan on the house I'm living in. No way I can quickly come up with the 20% down needed to buy an investment, especially in this real estate market. So what do you do then? If you have $3,000 to $5,000, I would suggest buying undervalued land. I've made a lot of money buying and flipping land, even during non-inflationary periods, because it's not too difficult to find great land deals. Let's suppose you find a piece of land worth $10,000, but the owner needs some cash and will sell it for $5,000. You now automatically have $5,000 in equity when you buy that land. Now let's suppose inflation or hyperinflation pushes the value of that land to $20,000, $30,000, or $50,000 in the next couple years. You still have the land. If you had $5,000 sitting in an account, it would be virtually worthless, but your land will still have value. It's just the numerical value of the land will change, and it will change in a good way because it will rise with inflation just like a house would. You can do the same thing on a smaller scale here. Let's say you have got the land deal I mentioned above for $5,000. It's worth $10,000, right? Now let's suppose inflation and hyperinflation happens, and in the next 5 years, that land gets pushed to a value of $50,000, $75,000, or $100,000. You could sell it and make a huge payment on your mortgage, student loans, car, or if you have other debt, you could use it for that. It's a great little hack that wouldn't be too risky because you're only risking $5,000. You just have to park a little bit of money into the right piece of land and wait a little while, and voila, you made some profit from inflation. You can use it now to pay off some of your debt. I hope that made sense. Give me a thumbs up if you're still with me. Okay, but what if you don't want land? Do me a favor and hit the like button so that the YouTube algorithm will show this video to more people. What if you don't want land? Or you can't find a deal, but you have roughly the same amount of cash, $3,000 to $5,000, maybe a little bit less. In that case, you could consider commodities like gold or silver or guns. I believe all those items will hold their value and rise with inflation. They may even outpace inflation. Gold holds its value. We know this from history. There's only a certain amount of gold in the world, and it will always be valuable. Silver holds its value. There's only so much of it, and it's such a great conductor that it's used in almost all electronics. In fact, many would argue that silver is undervalued right now anyway, and it's a good investment even without the potential of inflation. But that's a different video for a different discussion. In fact, if you'd like to hear my thoughts on silver, let me know in the comments below, and if I get enough comments to justify it, I might make a video on precious metals. In the meantime, if you've never bought any physical gold or silver, it can be a little overwhelming, and there are a ton of scams out there. I bought my first physical gold and silver this past year, and I had to ask a few of my buddies that I knew who were into that sort of thing the best place to get it. Guess what? It's like everything else. It couldn't be simpler. You order it online, they ship it straight to you. I know it's a little worrisome at first because you think it's going to get lost in the mail, but I've never had a shipment not show up or get swiped. They ship it in a pretty low-key little box, and it's kind of hard to know what's in there. I'll put a link in the description to the company I order from if you want to get gold and silver and it's your first time ordering. Now for the guns. I know guns are not commodities. Guns, guns, guns. We Americans like our guns. You may be thinking, why spend money on guns? Well, if inflation and hyperinflation starts getting out of control and there's even a minor breakdown in society, guns will keep you, your stuff, and your family safe, or at least a little safer. Even if there's no immediate threat, guns can make you feel safer. In the event of hyperinflation, some things will lose value because people will stop spending money on them. They aren't a necessity or a legitimate investment. Shout out to my subscriber Daxer the Bot, I hope I said that right, who rightly pointed out in my last video that toilet paper will never be expensive, mostly because you can wipe your butt with anything. If things get expensive, you're not going to spend your money on toilet paper. But you can't protect your family with anything. A stick is good, a slingshot is better, a sword is even better, but a gun beats them all. That means the value of things like gold, silver, land, and guns will rise as inflation does. So you'll always be able to sell or trade them. Plus, if your neighbors forgot to get a gun, you can rob them of their garden vegetables fairly easily. I'm just kidding. That wouldn't be neighborly. I'm not condoning it. Okay, so we've discussed land, gold, silver, and guns. What about stocks? Before diving into this, I must remind you one more time. I'm just a lone soul trying to navigate this world the same as you. Don't take any advice unless you like to gamble or have a high tolerance for risk because you're taking a risk just by listening to me. I'll share how I'm investing during this time, but again, don't take my advice unless you're comfortable with it. My wife and I have two brokerage accounts, one for each of us. They are both Roth IRAs, so any gains we have won't be taxed on as long as we don't touch them until retirement. She's not into the stock market thing, so I manage them both. By having two accounts, I can put in twice as much money to play with each year. Let me start with what I used to do. I used to be conservative. I tried to buy solid companies when they seemed to dip and hold them. I've changed my tactics, and I did this a few years before the pandemic hit. Here's my thinking. After 15 years of having those accounts, they fluctuated a little bit. They were up some, down some. Last I checked, they were up maybe double after 15 years. But I don't get excited about double in 15 years, especially with the ROI I'm making on land. We aren't wealthy, but we aren't hurting, at least not right now. We have a decent retirement plan aside from our Roth IRAs, and I think we'll be just fine no matter what. But I got to thinking, since these are completely tax-free, I should stop going for base hits and only go for home runs. So that's what I've been doing the last few years, and it's much more exciting. Now that being said, it's much more risky. The key is that those accounts don't have to produce anything for us to be okay. Translation, we can lose it all and we'll be just fine. So a few years ago, I sold out of everything safe and I'm investing only in high risk, but potentially very high reward, high growth stocks. Home runs, if you will. So every single one of our investments is in one of the following areas, and I'm sticking with my strategy even during inflation or potential inflation. Number one, I'm investing in blockchain or blockchain technology companies. When banks started getting in on blockchain, I realized Bitcoin might go away or be banned, but blockchain technology, now that's here to stay. So I'm investing in that. Cannabis related companies. I don't smoke it, I don't promote it, and I don't condone it. But the fact is, it's illegal. So at this point, it's a little baby industry. At some point though, I believe it's going to become federally legal for recreational use. When this happens, institutional investors who aren't in the market right now and hedge funds with deep pockets who aren't in the market right now will be investing. It will be a race to become the Budweiser of the marijuana industry. They will be overspending and trying to make that happen because whomever becomes the brand name for that industry will make billions with a B. You've heard of dot-com millionaires? Well, my belief is that when cannabis becomes federally legal, average Joes with money in the market will become rich overnight, or at least very, very quickly. The key is to have money already positioned in companies that are positioned to benefit from that change in law. It could also be beautiful if your money was invested in a tax-free Roth IRA. I'm just saying. Okay, number three, real estate, but specifically real estate connected to the cannabis industry. Now, I know technically this is the same thing as cannabis-related stock, but it's a little different because it's real estate. So you're getting a two-for-one special here. If you're looking for something to protect you during inflation, a company that focuses on real estate would be a good choice. If it happens to be focused on real estate for a growing sector of the economy, that's even better. I suppose you could also invest in gold and silver related stocks or gun companies, but personally, if I'm investing in gold, I'd rather have the hard asset. Now, another option you may want to consider is getting a new car early, even though you're not ready to buy one, and financing it with a fixed interest rate. This goes back to the other hack I mentioned with real estate about buying multiple houses and then inflating out. This is the first time in history, definitely in my lifetime that I know of, where a person's used car might be worth more than they owe on it. It might have went up in value. Cars are expensive right now, but if they dip in the near future and you feel inflation is definitely coming and you can afford it, it may not be a bad time to get another car. If you happen to currently have a car that's paid off, keep it. And then later down the road, when inflation drives its price up, you can sell that car that's paid off and pay off your new one. What if nothing I've said so far resonates with you, or you don't have that much to spend, but you still want to be prepared for inflation? Well, when you can't invest, prepare. If you can't profit from inflation, you can at least be prepared for it. There are a bazillion ways to get prepared. Consider stocking up on non-perishable foods and other non-perishable items you know you'll need or other people will need, but you don't want to pay the higher price for later. This can minimize the effects of inflation as it rises because you'll have already bought some of that stuff and pre-bought some of that stuff. You can also prepare by learning a new skill that will be useful. YouTube is a great place to start, so I commend you for being here, but take that learning to another level. Start learning about animals, farming, canning, bread making, solar energy, gardening, or anything else you can think of that would be beneficial. Find something you want to learn about that you think would be beneficial during inflation or hyperinflation, then start learning that skill. Be sure you subscribe and check out one of these other awesome videos.